It is my distinct pleasure to welcome our guest speaker today, Pierre Beaudoin, President and CEO of Bombardier, Inc. Pierre leads a global company that is the largest supplier of rail equipment, systems, and services, and the third largest manufacturer of civil aircraft in the world. He began his career at Bombardier through its Marine Products Division in 1985, and later named that division's president in 1984. In April of 1996, Mr. Beaudoin was appointed President and Chief Operating Officer of Bombardier's Recreational Products Group with operational responsibility for its six associated product lines. In February 2001, Mr. Beaudoin assumed duties as President of the Business Aircraft Division in Bombardier Aerospace. He was named President and COO of Bombardier Aerospace in October that same year and assumed responsibility for all operations and product divisions of the aerospace business. In December 2004, Mr. Beaudoin was appointed Executive Vice President of Bombardier Inc., in addition to his duties as President and COO of the Bombardier Aerospace. With this appointment, he became a member of the Board of Directors for the corporation and joined the Chairman of the Board and CEO and President of Bombardier Transportation as part of the newly created Office of the President. He was named President and Chief Executive Officer of Bombardier Inc. in June of 2008. Mr. Beaudoin studied business administration at Brebeuf College and industrial relations at McGill University in Montreal. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Pierre Beaudoin to our podium.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's truly an honor for me to be here today and address the members and guests of the Wings Club. As you know, this prestigious club has played an important role in the aviation industry over the last 70 years. Like the Wings Club, Bombardier was founded in 1942. But a 70th anniversary isn't the only thing that we have in common. We also share your passion for fostering progress in our industry. I am here today to make a case for change. The essence of progress in any society lies in new ideas, bold moves that push the envelope. It is rooted in a spirit of change. Without that spirit, we would not have the light bulb, the television, the internet, or even the airplane. Each of these innovations faced skeptics at the outset. Doubting Thomases are part and parcel of the change process. And in some way, they play a useful check in driving change agents towards material constructive change. Constructive change is the mindset that Bombardier grew up on. So did the aviation industry. And it's crucial that we keep this alive. Today's airline operators are demanding new products to meet the requirement of their rapidly changing reality. Our industry must keep pace with those needs. True agents of change don't wait for all the stars to be aligned. We make game-changing moves. What we look for, and visionary ones are very good at it, is a clear and compelling need, an unserved market niche, an opportunity to make things better. Some 70 years ago, my grandfather, Joseph Armand Bombardier, invented a track vehicle to transport school children, doctors, or even the local priests across the snowbound roads of Quebec. This innovation was followed by the recreational snowmobile, the Ski-Doo, in 1959, which later gave rise to the Sea-Doo watercraft. And both of these innovations launched brand new recreational sport. This drive for progress and the evolution of mobility has always been part of our DNA. In our aerospace group, it has enabled us to accomplish a great deal in 25 short years. We have created, led, and revitalized categories. This includes giving birth to the regional jet market with our family of CRJ aircraft. And despite at the time the widely held belief that the new jet culture would kill the turboprop, we also spearheaded the revival of the turboprop category with our Q400. At the heart of change lies a willingness to make bold moves, an unwavering focus to find the niches with unserved requirement, a commitment to listen to our customers' express and unexpressed needs to ultimately create better ways to move the world. What you may not know is that we are also a global leader in rail technology. We have over 100,000 rail cars and locomotives in service around the world. If you've ridden a tram in Brussels, the metro in Berlin or Delhi, the air train at the New York JFK airport, or a high-speed train in China, it was likely a Bombardier product. Routes that once had 4 flights a day now have 2. As a result, cities like Allentown, Pennsylvania, Providence, Rhode Island, Toledo, Ohio, are experiencing declines in choice, frequency, and service. To provide these smaller but important urban centers with better connectivities, operators need more efficient single-aisle aircraft. That's the only way these routes will remain economically viable. Our industry also needs to think outside the box when it comes to exploring different business models to address the mobility needs of Asia's rapidly growing middle class. I suspect that frequency will also be a key issue in this fast-moving market, and not just in Asia's large cities. With their low-yield flights, these emerging economies cannot afford the inefficiency of operating older aircraft at suboptimal seat costs. Also, as the world's emerging economies grow, so will the demand for air travel and consequently aircraft. But if we continue to operate suboptimal fleets and to rely on outdated airspace management system and airport infrastructure, the impact of our environmental footprint will put a serious damper onto our growth and our success. At Bombardier, we are committed to doing our part to help the aviation industry address its economic, connectivity, and environmental challenges, in other words, to drive the evolution of mobility in aerospace. When we launched the CRJ Regional Jet in 1989, we created a whole new market worldwide. The CRJ, an aircraft tailored to the size of the market, went on to become the best-selling regional aircraft program in history. Since then, we have become one of the industry's most prolific generator of new technology and products, launching a total of 28 successful new aircraft programs. This includes our Global Express, now called the Global 6000, which gave birth to an entirely new breed of business aircraft. Today, we have an additional 6 new aircraft programs that are scheduled to enter into service between now and 2017. The Global Vision Flight Deck is entering into service right now in early 2012. The Lear 85, the Global 7000 and Global 8000, and the 2 members of our C-Series commercial aircraft family, the CS-100 and CS-300. As you know, the C-Series is the world's only all-new aircraft in the 100 to 149 seat segments. It is another example of us listening to operators and responding with an aircraft that is optimized to meet their evolving needs. Our logic for the C-Series is simple. The last time we saw a 100% new aircraft family optimized for these segments was the DC-9s in the 1960s. There has been derivatives of bigger aircraft since then, but even the last one is the Boeing 737NG, and that's 15 years ago. During this time, operators' needs in this segment changed rapidly. The industry, however, was focused somewhere else. The two major players were busy developing larger long-haul aircraft to capture the bigger piece of the revenue pie. Of course, these manufacturers now want airlines to grow all their airplane size. They argued that demand is elastic in all markets and that airlines should, in other words, trade variable costs against fixed costs. The C-Series program stimulated the established players, who then woke up and scrambled to offer solution to their customers, solution of their own, lowering seat costs. So competition is a good thing, and I think it's a good thing in any industry. However, in the category of 100 to 149 seats, we remain the only OEM providing carriers with what they want, an optimized aircraft that will deliver a step change in operating economics. The C-Series is the greenest and most cost-effective mainliner in its niche. Compared to existing aircraft, in this segment, it will deliver a 20% fuel burn advantage, a 15% cash operating cost advantage. Its clean sheet design will drive down CO2 emission by 20% and make the C-Series four times quieter, as well as give the aircraft exceptional wide-body comfort. And when compared to re-engine derivative, the C-Series still provides with a 12% fuel burn advantage. Now you may ask, what's the market in this segment? Well, we're forecasting a 35% increase in the 100 to 149 fleet over the next 20 years. That's 7,000 aircraft deliveries, or more than $420 billion in sales. Half of this market will be generated by replacing old aircraft, and the other half will come from growth in new business models, and of course, growth in emerging market. While this represents only 10 to 15% of the commercial aircraft market by revenue, it provides Bombardier with a huge opportunity. It is understandable why the two established players would have neglected this niche, because of its size, but this segment fits perfectly well in our evolution of mobility strategy and our focus on developing transportation solutions. If frequency is important to an airline's success, and the market tells us that it is important, then this niche needs a competitive seat cost in a smaller aircraft, and that's where the C-Series comes in. Part of what makes the C-Series a game changer is its unmatched versatility. It is capable of covering the two extremes of aircraft performance. It can access small airport while offering the range and comfort to fly long missions of 6 hours or almost 3,000 nautical miles. It will create a new paradigm, much like low-cost carriers did when they changed the airline market in the last quarter of the 20th century. And like we did with the regional aviation with the CRJ. Because it is designed for optimal operation flexibility, the C-Series allows carriers to explore new types of routes and business models. This versatility is highlighted by the type of customers that are ordering the CS-100 and CS-300. To date, we have signed up major network carriers like Lufthansa and Korean Airline that see the C-Series as part of their sustainable fleet strategy. Premium airline like Sweden Malmo Aviation that want to be able to access city center airport with their short runway and very strict noise restriction. A leasing company, Lease Corporation International, that needs an asset with a whole lot of flexibility, and most recently, a full-service provider, Privat Air, that will operate an all-business class C-Series for its major network operator. This customer diversity speaks volume about the flexibility of the C-Series to meet the airline transportation requirement worldwide. And I am convinced that there's even more business models for the C-Series that we haven't yet imagined. As our industry evolves, it is clear to me that the comfortable days of duopoly in commercial and regional aircrafts are over. Today, it is a multiplayer's game in all segments, and that means increased innovation and passenger choice. The commercial aircraft duopoly is definitely feeling threatened. And in their case, the best defense appears to be a good offense when it comes to the C-Series. Skepticism about the feasibility of the CRJ was pretty much industry-wide at the time. In the end, the CRJ became the hottest commercial property in the sky, and we succeeded beyond the wildest dream of all but a few. I have no doubt that the C-Series will follow the same successful path as the CRJ. Some may believe that a re-engined aircraft with a 20-year-old design will be good enough. We see the future differently at Bombardier. We believe that good enough is not what our operators expect or need in this segment, especially considering the airline's tight margins. Like us, the industry is forecasting 7,000 units for the 100 to 149 seat category over the next 20 years. So volume is clearly not an issue. And in a business where margins are so tight, can airlines really afford to pass up on 10 to 15% cost advantage? The next predictor of failure is the C-Series slow order intake, which supposedly heralds the collapse of our competitiveness. This one is a case of some people playing fast and loose with their sales figure. First of all, we are not competing against the A320neo or the 737-800 MAX. Those are 160 passenger aircraft. When you compare apple to apple, we have outsold our competitors in the below 150 seat category, and our order trajectory is good as what we needed to be at this stage of the program. Today, we have over 300 orders, options, and purchase right for the C-Series, and have sold out our delivery slots for the next 2.5 years. I'm very comfortable with our pricing strategy, and as I mentioned, very comfortable with our customer diversity. Now, some skeptics are also saying that we won't be able to manage the C-Series global supply chain. The truth is that, as I said before, we are a global leader in two industries, rail and aerospace, where all we do day in and day out is manage complex projects involving suppliers from around the world. We're also the first aircraft OEM to create risk-sharing partnership with suppliers for our Global Express business jet program almost 2 decades ago. It's now second nature for us to integrate suppliers and manufacturing facilities from around the world into our new aircraft program. In the C-Series program, we share the same system and governance with our suppliers. We're also physically in the same building, working together on testing and integrating at our complete integrated aircraft system test area facility, we call the Siesta in Mirabel, Montreal. As we evolve, we integrate lessons learned from our previous aircraft program, as well as from our rail business, rail transportation group, where we design, build, and certify trains. And I'm sure you would understand that it's a big technical challenge also to design trains. Then there are those who assert that we won't be able to deliver the performance that we promise. Well, based on wind tunnels and engine testing, the C-Series performance looks very good and certainly meets our expectation. As I said before, we've designed 28 aircraft in 25 years. And historically, all of our aircraft at this stage of its development ended up delivering on their promised performance. Now, the last claim made by the C-Series skeptic attempts to cast a doubt on our ability to deliver on time. What can I tell you? I am not going to try to defend the track record of the two largest manufacturers, although I'm asked quite a few times. As of today, we continue to drive for the first delivery of the aircraft at the end of 2013. At this point, sub-assemblies are streaming in the doors at the Siesta, where we have gone from being a virtual aircraft to a real one. We are building our first test vehicle in Mirabel, and system integration and commissioning are going as well as what we had expected. In closing, as the C-Series program demonstrates, progress requires a vigorous face-off between the spirit of change and the status quo. We will not achieve what we need to achieve in the aviation industry without a spirited debate that leads to the evolution of mobility. We embrace this debate as a crucial stepping stone to the desired outcome of constructive change. We are convinced, and so are a growing number of operators, that the C-Series is a viable instrument of this positive change. Ladies and gentlemen, change and progress are in the air, and at Bombardier, we are helping to drive it with our all-new C-Series commercial aircraft. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pierre Beaudoin, could we please have one more round of applause? Pierre, thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. To commemorate your time with us here at the Wings Club, we have a small memento for you, and we hope you'll think of us fondly when you look at it.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful.